Hello friends, welcome to the class of High Voltage Engineering. So in previous lecture, we have seen the power frequency withstand volt test on transformer. In today's lecture, I am going to discuss the impulse voltage test on transformer. So the level of switching surges, if we are considering the expansion in the extra high voltage system and ultra high voltage transmission networks, are actually very much high, and therefore the high voltage equipments must operate reliably to deal with this more volatile and dynamic operating conditions. Okay, so as we are assuming the expansion of the power system networks, where we are going to deal with the extra high voltage and ultra high voltage transmission voltages. So if we are considering the level of these voltages and the level of the over voltages, those are arising either internal or by means of external, then they are very much large in magnitudes. Okay, so whatever the equipment that we are installing to operate such a high level of power system networks, then they must be operated stably and reliably with under all this volatile and dynamic operating conditions. So what could be done? So to satisfy the performance characteristic of high voltage equipment under the presence of the over voltage stresses, the over voltage, it means it may be produced by means of the external factors like the lightning strokes. When they are striking on the line, they will boost up the voltage level. The another factor, maybe the overvoltage situation arising because of the fault produced in the power system network, like if suppose the power electronic switches or the circuit breakers are getting maloperated, or suppose the transformer is suddenly cut off from the load, then under those situations there might be the production of a longer voltage magnitude, longer overvoltage magnitude, which may destroy the insulation of the high voltage equipment. So to satisfy the performance characteristic of the high voltage equipment under the presence of lightening over voltages and switching over voltages, it is mandatory to conduct the impulse voltage test. So the test can be performed by generating the standard lightening impulse or the switching impulse voltages in the high voltage laboratories using the impulse voltage generator. So in high voltage laboratories, the impulse voltage generators are being used to generate the impulse voltages of a standard wave shape as specified by the IEC standard to test the impulsive or the transient voltage withstanding capacity of the insulation. Okay, so with the help of the impulse voltage generators, we can produce the impulse voltage or the over voltage due to the lightening phenomena as well as due to the switching phenomena. So the impulse voltage generator generates the high magnitude of voltage, which is larger than, of course it is larger than the operational voltage. Normally the range varies between 3 to 4.5 times the nominal system voltage, with a standard wave shape of specified by IEC and Indian standards IS. Okay, so during the conduction of the test, you have to produce the over voltage as per the IEC and IS standard. The generated impulse voltage is then applied to the insulator or the other equipment under the test to check its impulse voltage withstanding capacity as well as the probability of the flashover. So generally, in case of insulators, the impulse voltage test is not only performed to determine its impulse withstanding capacity, but it is also performed to determine its flashover probability. Okay, so in the lecture of that insulator testing, I have discussed about the flashover test under dry and wet condition, as well as I have discussed about the 50% flashover test and 100% flashover test. Whereas in case of the test, in case of the transformer testing, the impulse voltage test is to perform for determining the impulsive withstanding capacity of its insulation. So in general, lightning, as you know that, it is a very common phenomena that you can observe in transmission line because of their taller height. Okay, so this lightning stroke on the line conductor will cause the impulsive voltage when it strikes onto the transmission line conductor. But generally, transmission line conductor which carries the power is generally protected by the thin conductor. If you can see, it is mounted over the top of the tower. Okay, so this is a one kind of a protecting conductor, or you can consider it as a one kind of shielding which provides protection to the transmission line conductor. Suppose here there is an insulator string, and then you can see there is a conductor. Okay, so this conductor protects this transmission line conductor which carries the power against the direct contact of lightning stroke. So lightning stroke is actually striking on this top conductor. As a result, when the stroke is striking, it will be braked and make it open. So this is how this transmission line conductor is protected against the lightning stroke. Let me wipe this for the further discussion. So terminal equipment of transmission line, like a power transformer, experiences this lightning impulse voltage. Okay, if suppose the stroke is striking at the switchyard location, okay, and suppose the lightning arrestor is not operated, so for a moment of time, it may be the chance that the impulse voltage is maybe acting at the insulation of the transformer. So again, during all kind of online switching operations in the system, there will be a switching impulses in the network, and magnitude of this switching impulses may be about 3.5 times more than the system voltage. So if suppose we are considering 11 kilovolt, suppose 11 kilovolt of network is there, and switching over voltage is supposed to be produced due to the malfunctioning of this connected switches, then the voltage in the system may rise up to 33 kilovolt. So insulation of the transformer connected in 11 kV system must be capable to withstand this three times more the system voltage value. Okay, so in a root cause, we can say that if any weakness in the insulation is found, then it may cause the failure of the transformer. So to ensure this effectiveness of insulation system of a transformer, it must confirms the dielectric test. So dielectric test also include this impulse voltage test. But power frequency, okay, in previous lecture we have seen the power frequency withstanding voltage test. So it only gives the idea about the insulation withstanding capacity by considering the overvoltage magnitude at power frequency. But what would be the case where the overvoltage has a different frequency? So in that case, the impulse voltage test must be performed by applying a shorter duration of over voltage magnitude of the standard wave shape, normally said as a lightning impulse, and the longer duration, okay, because if we are considering the switching impulses, then they will lies in the circuit or they will remain present into the system over a longer time, from milliseconds to the several seconds. So we have to generate that sort of the data or that sort of the pulse in the high voltage laboratory to check the performance of the insulation. So here you can see that see the wave shape for the lightning impulse and the switching impulse as per IEC 60060 of part 1. Okay, so generally the lightning impulse is having the wave shape of 1.2 by 50 microsecond, and the switching surge has a wave shape of 250 by 2500 microsecond. So as you know that the impulse voltage wave is actually defined as a unidirectional double exponential wave which rises to a peak magnitude in a very short duration, and then it will reduces towards zero more or less rapidly. Okay, and the equation from where we can calculate this peak magnitude, the peak magnitude of generated voltage is VO max is equal to V0 upon K beta minus alpha into e raised to minus alpha t minus e raised to minus beta t, where alpha and beta both are the discharging and charging time constants respectively. So its value normally depends upon the RC parameters. Okay, so from the wave shape calculate the value for the wavefront time. If suppose the engineer is following American standard, then it can be calculated from these formulas. Okay, and if suppose one is following Indian standard, then it can be calculated from this formula. So wavefront time specified by the American standard for the calculation is 1.67 into T90 minus T30, where T90 represents the time taken by a wave to attain the 90% of peak magnitude, and T30 represents the time taken by the wave to attain 30% of peak magnitude. Okay, so T90 and T30 both will representing the time at which the 90% and 30% of peak magnitude has been achieved by the wave shape. And when it will be multiplied with the factor of 1.67, it will give the exact time at which the wave is attaining the peak magnitude, and that is the wavefront time. Okay, so if suppose one is taking 90 and 30 limit, then multiplying factor is 1.67. If one is using 90% and 10% of values, then the multiplying factor is 1.25. So this multiplying factor is changing as you are selecting the other specifications to notify this wavefront time. The wave tail time can be calculated from this formula T50 minus TO, where TO represents the time of origin, and time of origin is calculated according to the American standard. If we have take this 90% and 30% of limit, then T0 is equal to T30 minus U30 by U90 minus U30 into T90 minus T30. If one is using Indian standard, then 30 is replaced by 10. Okay, where U represents the voltage magnitude at a particular time interval. So generally this T0 is very very small, and hence it is neglected compared with the time taken by the wave to attain a 50% of peak magnitude. So TO is normally taken as a zero, so your tail time will now becomes equals to T50 only. So wavefront time in general, it varies in between 0.84 microseconds to 1.56 microseconds. So this value actually represents the lightning impulse. The wave tail time 40 microseconds to 60 microseconds. So lightning impulse voltage, which is generated by means of impulse voltage generator in high voltage laboratories for the testing purpose as per this IEC standard, is 1.2 by 50 microsecond with tolerance of plus or minus 30% in wavefront time and plus or minus 20% in wavetail time. The switching impulse voltage having the wave shape of 250 by 2500 microsecond with tolerance of plus or minus 50 microsecond in wavefront time and plus or minus 500 microseconds in wavetail time. So these standard wave shapes are normally produced in the high voltage laboratories with impulse voltage generators. So here you can see the photograph for this impulse voltage generator, which can produce the lightning impulse as well as the switching impulse. Okay, again you can see that this is a single phase device. Okay, so I will show you that how the connections can be done when you want to perform the impulse voltage test on the transformer. So let us see the videos to understand that how we can prepare the transformer for the impulse voltage test, and once it will be prepared, how the test can be conducted.
Digital Test Lab. The validation of a flawless execution of a robust.
Sorry.
Digital Test Lab. The validation of a flawless execution of a robust high voltage power transformer design comes from IEEE standard testing of the unit in a test lab. VTGT has the most modern automated digital test lab. There are three main tests performed in the test lab: transient impulse lightning and switching tests, high voltage high pot tests. These two tests will check transient and steady state over voltage capability of the installation. Power measurement, impedance, voltage, and induced voltage test. This test is meant to check for thermal and partial discharge capability of the transformer. State-of-the-art impulse generator made by high voltage company based in Germany uses remote digital controls that are fully operated from a console located in a sealed controlled cabin. 12 200 kV sections give this generator capability to test up 2400 kV BIL. 365 kilojoules of energy. We have already tested 1650 kV BIL transformer using this equipment. For high pot, we use a resonance test set as opposed to using an old-fashioned inductive transformer. In a resonance test set, the capacitance and inductance are tuned to resonance frequency to achieve the desired voltages. The two main advantages of this method are: number one, you do not need a humongous transformer to test a 345 kV or 500 kV unit, so this is a significant saving in the precious test floor space. And number two, during high pot, older transformer-based high pot equipment had a tendency to feed more power into the fault, thus causing severe damage to the unit, whereas the protective controls of resonance test sets are highly sophisticated, capable of isolating the source from transformer within a very short time, in case there is a test failure. For power measurement and induced voltage test, we have two redundant sources: a variable frequency, fully static or digital power source that can switch to any frequency or any voltage remotely. In fact, it can also operate LTCs remotely for the readings at each tap. We also have a backup source that uses two sets of generators, one for the power measurements and the other high frequency generator for the induced voltage test. The control cabin has consoles from where the actual tests are conducted. After the initial configuration of transformer unit, all the external doors are locked. Any unlocked door will automatically prevent the console buttons from operating a nice safety feature. The entire circuit configuration and the controls are on GUI screens. The test engineer simply sits at the console and pushes the buttons. More importantly, the test diagnostics are built into the software. The following example will illustrate the significance of this feature. Every transformer is designed for certain basic insulation level BIL. For example, a 230 kV transformer is typically designed for 900 kV BIL. And when this transformer is tested, first, the reduced wave, say 50% of 900 kV, is applied to the transformer and the voltage distribution is plotted as a fingerprint of this transformer. Now, a full wave is applied and the voltage distribution across the transformer is recorded again. The two plots are now compared. Any visual anomaly between the two waveforms will indicate an impulse failure. Experienced eyes are required to detect this. Our test system uses software that will automatically superimpose the waveform and precisely detect the type, magnitude, and location of the fault in case there's one.
Let us see the other video. So you have examined that the impulse is generated when all the spheres are triggered at the same instant. Okay, so initially the capacitors which you have which you can see in this impulse voltage generator circuit, they are connected in parallel initially to charge at the same voltage, and once they are charged at the desired voltage value, at the desired or the supplied voltage value to obtain the test voltage level, they will be discharged immediately at the same instant, and which connects them in series, and thus it produces the impulse voltage across the transformer's winding.
فلاش المفروض النهارده المفروض تشيك بتاعها النهارده
ونشوف دول بقى لسه هيعمل البريتش رايز على الفار
الثاني انا مش عارف هيحاول ازاي ايه؟
الاثنين
تمبريتش رايز دول اصلا بياخدوا وقت هيحاول ازاي النهارده هياخدوا هيلحقوا ازاي النهارده النهارده برضه لحد الساعه 8 ولا ايه؟
لغايه 5
هو 5 هيلحق يخلص؟ صعب
Okay, so once the impulse is generated, the voltage across the capacitor will reduce, which is unable to recreate the spark across the sphere gap assembly or the sparking gap. So once the voltage is dropping down due to the continuous application of the supply voltage, the capacitor will charge. Okay, so the charging time of this capacitors is depending upon the capacitance of the capacitor and the charging resistance value. So normally it will take a time of approximately 1 minute or so to charge up to the supplied voltage, and the discharging time is very, very small. Okay, that you have seen over here. Okay, so at the same instant, all the sphere gaps are triggered at the same time, and produces the impulse voltage. So during each and every applications of the impulses across the transformer winding, we have to wait until all the capacitors are fully charged. So in case of the impulse voltage generators, two modes of operations you can achieve. One is the manual operation and second is the automatic operation. So to obtain the manual operation, one has to set length of gap between the spheres somewhat higher than its breakdown voltage value. And then you have to manually trigger to produce the impulse voltages. Whereas in case of automatic operation of impulse voltage generator, the testing engineer has to set a length of gap between the two spheres exactly equals to its breakdown voltage value. So when the capacitor is fully charged, the breakdown of this gap is initiated at the same instant to obtain this automatic operation.
تخيل هو مش مشغل السخانات جوه في ناس مثلجين زي احنا في الاخر حتى جوه تقريبا عاملين حاجه كده اه اسمع بقى صغيرة
في كم
دي 110 لا
So this is how the impulse water test is being performed in high voltage laboratories. So I will share this video link in the description of this chapter in my YouTube channel. So this is how the connections look like when you are performing the impulse voltage test. So here you can see this is the transformer which is under the test. Okay, and these all are the measuring compartments of the impulse voltage test circuit. Okay, so everything you can observe over the screen of the CRO. This is the rod gap which is used to create the chopped impulse. This is the triggering circuit of impulse voltage generator. And this will represent the pre-charged capacitors. So initially this sphere gap is open circuited because the voltage across it is not capable to flashes over this sphere gap assembly. So when the voltage across this capacitor becomes equal to the breakdown voltage value of this gap, then the spark is initiated. So this will discharge its entire energy into this high voltage transformer. So according to this standard IEC 60076 part 3, the resistances of resistor must be selected so that the voltage at adjacent terminal do not exceed 75% of test voltage and resistance does not increase or increase beyond this 500 ohms, because these resistances are acting as a one type of damping resistor, so they of course affect over the peak magnitude of the impulse voltages. So in transformer testing, it is essential to record the waveforms. Okay, so waveforms can be recorded by connecting the scopes. Okay, you have seen the CROs are mounted at various locations just to capture the wave shapes of applied voltage and current through the winding under the test. Okay, so by observing the wave shapes for this voltage and current, one can identify the behavior of insulation under the applied impulse voltage. So sometimes the transferred voltage in the secondary and neutral currents are also be recorded. So impulse testing is done as this following sequence. So first one has to apply the impulse voltage magnitude of 75% of its basic impulse level, okay, of this transformer. Then one full voltage wave of 100% BIL is applied. Then two chopped waves. The chopped waves are produced by means of rod gaps, okay, of 100% of BIL value. Then one full wave of 100% BIL. Then one full wave of 75% of BIL is applied. So it is very important to see that the grounding should be proper and the winding which are not under the test are suitably terminated. Okay, otherwise it may impose the hazardous behavior to the transformer's insulation. So let us see that how this fault can be detected and located during the impulse test. So one can go with general observation. The fault can be located by general observation, like noise in the tank or smoke or bubbles in the breather. So this is the one observation through which one can locate the fault when the impulse voltage test is being performed on transformer. The another is one can use this voltage oscillogram method. So fault or the failure appears as a partial or complete collapse of applied voltage wave. So generally during the impulse voltage test, when you are capturing the wave shape, you may have the possibility to obtain three different types of the wave shape based on the insulation's condition. Number one is you can obtain full impulse voltage. Okay, full impulse means like this. If suppose you are getting a full impulse voltage without any sort of the distortion or without any clipping, then you can say that the insulation is capable enough to withstand the applied voltage magnitude as per the standard. If during the testing, suppose one is observing the oscillations either at the wavefront side or the tail side or at the peak locations, then this will indicates the presence of the internal imperfections. It means that internal imperfection will always be the source of partial discharges. Okay, so during the impulse voltage test, there might be the situation that the partial failure maybe takes place. So that partial discharges can be observed by means of this oscillatory wave shape. And suppose the complete collapse means the complete failure is supposed to being observed during the impulse voltage test. That is known as a chopped impulse, and this chopping may occur at the tail portion of the wave or the front portion of the wave or even at the peak of the wave. So as it represents a complete breakdown, it means that the insulation is not capable to withstand the applied voltage magnitude. So one is the full impulse. Okay, that means that insulation is good enough to withstand the applied impulse voltage. If suppose oscillatory wave shape is captured, then it indicates the partial discharges, means that the insulator is designed imperfectly, so it needs a revision in the design to obtain the required set of withstanding capacity. And third one is chopped impulse. It means that the insulation is poorly designed and it is not capable to withstand the applied impulse voltage magnitude. So during the conduction of the test, one has to analyze the wave shapes which you are capturing during the conduction of the test to get the decision. So here you can see these are the some sort of the wave shapes that you can observe while you are performing the impulse voltage test. Okay, so RFW, it means it represents a reduced full wave voltage. FW, that indicates a full wave. Okay, so here it will represent the fault situation arising in the transformer's winding during the test. So figure A represents failure from line lead to the ground through the oil, and second represents 8.5% of winding is failed. Okay, so if suppose this type of the faults are arising, then you can have the observation of like these wave shapes. Another approach is the neutral current method. So in neutral current method, a record of impulse current flowing through a resistive shunt between neutral and ground point is used to detect the fault. So neutral current oscillogram consists of high frequency oscillations and a low frequency disturbance and a current rise due to reflection from ground end of the windings. So when fault occurs, like arcing between the turns or from turn to the ground, a train of high frequency pulses similar to that in the front of impulse current wave are observed in oscillograph, and the wave shape gets changed. So if the fault is local like partial discharge, then you have only the high frequency oscillations which you can observe in the oscillogram, oscilloscope, without observing the change in the wave shape. So if you have the high frequency oscillations, then one can drive the conclusion of producing the local failures, means the partial discharges. And if suppose the heavy fault takes place, like the arcing between the two turns or between turn and the ground, then there is a train of high frequency pulses similar to that which you have seen in the impulse current wave are normally observed, in which the wave shape is completely changing. Whereas in case of this localized faulty conditions, the wave shape will remain as it is, but the high frequency oscillations are being observed in the wave shape. So this is how this faults can be detected during the impulse voltage test. So the sensitivity of the method decreases if other winding not under test are grounded. Transfer surge current method. So in this method, the voltage across a resistive shunt connected between the low voltage winding and the ground is used for the fault detection. A short high frequency discharge oscillations is capacitively transferred at the event of failure and is recorded. So the fault at further distance from neutral are also clearly located. The wave shape is distorted depending upon the location and type of the fault, and hence can be more clearly detected. And after the location of the fault, the type of the fault can be observed by dismantling the winding and looking for shared insulation or melted parts on the copper winding. So you have to open this transformer just to locate the fault. So this is successful in the case of major faults. Local faults or partial discharges are self-healing and escape observation. So this is how the impulse voltage test is conducted and how the different types of faults can be located by using the different methods. Thank you.